Welcome back at the Tech Talk Studio, day number two on the NCSC One Conference. Today I will be doing some of the interviews together with Ellie van der Heuvel, the head of the National Cybersecurity Center. And here at the right of me, we have Jane Wainwright. You're senior manager in cybersecurity at PricewaterhouseCoopers. You served for 12 years at the British Military Intelligence. You were head of the corporate security of London 2012 Olympic Games.
Great.
And that's why you're here, right? Because
yep.
You had a presentation about all the security issues governing there, because you were responsible for information security, personal security, and data protection. How was it in 2012 to do this job?
I think it was better than I thought it would be. So I joined LOCOG, which was the organizing committee of the Olympic Games, back in 2009. And you think, oh, 2012 seems so long away. And everything was about planning. So we were just sat in meeting rooms like you would typically do working in any organization. We had a few maps out. We thought what it would look like. You know, we'd kind of war game it almost. But when it come to it at the end, the exhilaration, I think, was just unprecedented. When you see the fruits of your labor and you actually walk into a venue or you get to see it on the TV, you think, wow, I did that. Not me, obviously, you know, individually, but collectively as a team. It was a phenomenal professional experience as well as personal.
Mm-hmm. And the historical context, there were some terrorist threats, there were some riots. How did you cope with that?
I think there was threats to the United Kingdom as a nation, not just to the Games, but the Games would have been a great platform for somebody to have, I suppose, used for illegitimate means or to have used to get some kind of political message across. So we were always mindful that the Games would be an attractive target, but not just from terrorism, but from things like ticketing fraud, people wanting to counterfeit mascots because they wanted to make money on the black market, or people just to get a kind of geopolitical message across, whether it be kind of single issue groups like Fathers for Justice or whatever you would have.
Security over there was governed as a whole, of course, but here we're at the cybersecurity conference. What was the cyber part of it? What were the main cyber threats which need to be coped with?
So I think these were understood from the outset, and half of the infrastructure was not connected to the outside world. So if you look at things like timing and scoring, if you were Usain Bolt, you would want to make sure that your time was qualified properly. So those systems and networks were not connected to the internet in any way, and they were
very
standalone
much.
Systems inside of the venue. That obviously would have been disastrous for us not to be able to tell Usain what his time was. He'd been training for so many years. So when you look at impact, you know, obviously a lot of the talks that we've had here around impact to national security or organizations. But what we were doing, which was quite unique at the Games, was impact to personal lives. And some of these athletes have been training since they were 3-4 years old for this very moment.
Yeah.
And that's why it's very critical for us to make sure that we protected them from those types of issues. But obviously we had the external threats as well. Whether it be through our sponsors, whether it be Coca-Cola, British Airways, McDonald's, all these different guys were also targets from the Games as well. There's always a back door to get in, obviously.
Of
and
course,
that's not to say that they were, but we had to consider everything when we were planning.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Jane, we had the Nuclear Security Summit in the Netherlands, and we learned a lot from your experience in England with the Olympics. The theme of this conference is smart coalitions. Have you had any other coalitions that you normally have in the light of organizing the Olympics?
So one of the biggest challenges we had was, I suppose, collaborating with government, in that those people that I mentioned earlier, such as McDonald's and Cadbury's, British Airways, it was unprecedented, the volume of people that had to come together to collaborate. So not only did you invite government in, the Olympic Delivery Authority, the International Olympic Committee, and all the other nations as well, we had to almost learn a kind of common language, because perceptions of security are very, very different depending on who you work for and what your experience is. And also things like protective marking of information. So one government organization may call it secret, where another organization calls it restricted. So that was one of the biggest challenges that we had, and the value of information was either often overestimated or underestimated, depending on who you were and what your perceptions of risk were. So our biggest challenges were getting everybody to kind of think in the same way. So we had our own kind of Olympic mentality when it came to security.
Well, probably not a great willingness to share information, or did they?
I think most of the lack of willingness was around trust. So these companies and organizations had come together for the very first time, and they didn't really know so much about each other. So whilst we had a common goal, we all wanted to make sure that the Games were safe and secure.
Yeah.
If I was giving you my information, what did it look like on the other side? How were you protecting that? And would you protect it as I would protect my own? So it was about relationships, trust, and transparency.
Yeah. I think it helps that you have a mutual goal, and the mutual goal we could set apart from summits and Olympic Games is making the world a more cyber secure place. And what I'm interested in is whether that cooperation you started has progressed. Are you still working with these parties or with some of those parties?
So I think it kind of set a really good precedent for people working together in the future. So obviously the Olympic Games finished and we all kind of had to leave, which was very sad. But lots of legacy was left behind as part of that organisation. So whether it be individually, we've gone on to our new roles and our new jobs, we've taken that experience with us, or government departments who never worked before now understand each other a bit better. So there's a great legacy when it came to the security.
Great. Shall we go back to cybersecurity again? Okay.
Good idea.
Because you're now senior manager in cybersecurity at PricewaterhouseCoopers.
Yeah.
What does your daily job look like?
So I lead the group for cyber and business resilience as well. So it's about 100 of us at the moment sat within a hub in London. So we look at all aspects of security. We have very, very technical guys that deal with threat vulnerability management. We have guys in our forensics practice that look at incident response, and they also look at kind of things like threat intelligence. But we look across the whole spectrum of cyber, whether it be from insider threats, we look at governance, we look at making sure that people have a good, strong culture within organisations. And we typically serve, within my particular business unit, the FTSE 100 clients from London. So vast variation of sectors, whether it be shipping, oil and gas, banking. So I think the beauty of doing what we do is we get to learn from so many different organisations of the best and bad bits of the kind of world of cyber as it is today.
I read this figure that in Europe, about 7% of the ICT workforce consists of women. Well, for me as a man, it looks a bit odd, you know. Everybody uses these devices, but there's only one half of the population who builds it, governs it, repairs it, sells it and stuff. In this 7%, it's also calculated the communication personnel, the lawyers, the PR. So there are very few women in information technology. Is it the same at your workplace or is it more balanced?
So I think at PricewaterhouseCoopers we have, it's fairly evenly split, I think, which is quite good for us. But I think in my experience out in industry, there is a disproportionate amount of men doing the jobs that maybe some of the females would like to do. And I think, you know, we've done some workshops ourselves in the UK. One of the themes that's come out of it is about perception. So from a younger age, it's about the boys kind of do that stuff because it's IT, when actually cybersecurity is far broader than IT. And one of the things I think we need to get ourselves away from is assuming it's just about technology. Yeah. So cyber isn't just about technology. There's so many other areas. And working with colleagues who are psychologists, for example, who can help you to understand as an organization how to change your culture when it comes to making sure people are safe online.
Yeah, you say in jobs females would like to do, so they are willing to do it. But let me turn the question around. What are we as men missing out once these women are not there?
Oh, you mean the strengths?
Yes, yes.
So I would suggest that it's difficult to stereotype. Well, it's easy to stereotype, should I say. The softer skills, I think, are what are often assumed to be the kind of the dynamic that the females bring in. But I think it's just about diversity in thought. It's not just about women are softer and gentler than men. I think sometimes women just think slightly differently about things because perhaps they've had different life experiences.
Yes. Well, my experience is that they're mostly at the connecting point. You know, you see at the top, there's a man, the silverback, and at the bottom, you see also a lot of men, you know, the specialists. But in the middle management, there the women reign. Is it with PricewaterhouseCoopers too, or is it by?
No, I think it's right across the board. And actually, I feel very fortunate to be at PricewaterhouseCoopers because right across the board, we have graduate schemes. So females and ladies come in as graduates, and actually you can diversify. So once you're in, you may come in thinking you're going to be an accountant, you may do your course, and actually you can move into cybersecurity later on. So we do engender that. That's a really positive part of being at PricewaterhouseCoopers. But I guess if you were to look at the world of CISOs, how many female CISOs are there across the world? And perhaps we could start by asking that question. Why is it that at the senior level in cyber, there are not many women there doing those types of jobs? And I think, you know, nepotism probably has a lot to play there.
At KPM, we have JJ Balu, which is a very good CISO. You know her?
No, I don't.
Oh, she's walking around here. You should talk to her. But
do you think that women should organize a network in order to join forces and, you know, get the higher level jobs? Or do you have a different view on that?
So I think I disagree that nepotism is the way in. So we you know, I see a lot of it in the UK where we have a lot of ex-military or police guys, and I'm ex-military myself, I'm very proud to say so, but some people use that as a door opener, and it's a little bit Masonic, and I don't know if you know what I mean by that, but kind of backhand, here's my friend, he can come in when I leave. We see a lot of that. So I think that's a shame to see that, because there's so many different skills that other people can bring, whether it be male or female. There is this kind of, this view of what the cybersecurity professional looks like, and I think that's deep-seated in history, where people have come in through being ex-military or police or technologists, and I think that will get diluted as time goes on. You can now study this subject at university, you can study cyber or information security, and that door's open to everybody. So I think that will kind of help as the future moves forward.
But that's the top of IT. My notion is that we also need more women in the bottom, you know, the specialized technical jobs. My theory on that is that technology there is just being presented too boring. I've been in technical education too, with 400 guys and only 3 women. And you know, these guys, well, they just like doing boring stuff because it gets the job done, they get paid for it. But how could we make ICT more exciting for women?
So we have something in the United Kingdom called the Cybersecurity Challenge. I'm not sure if you're aware of it.
Yeah.
And we promote this through schools by allowing children at kind of middle school, secondary school age to participate in almost gaming around cybersecurity.
Right. Gaming. That's
so that's really important, because they relate to that, right? So it's almost a demystify to say it's not just about sitting there programming all day. There's a little bit more to do with it. And we have roles within those cybersecurity challenges where somebody takes the role of the leader, somebody takes the role of the incident response manager, for example.
Yes.
So it gives them insight into all the different types of roles that you can undertake in cyber. It's not just about being technical.
Yeah. Ellie, you just meant... Oh, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, I'd like to add something, because the way you bring it is like we have enough people, technicians, to do the work, and we're only missing women.
We don't.
I want to mention that.
Too few.
We are recruiting at the National Cybersecurity Center, and it's really hard to find the right people. And I was wondering if you have the same challenges as we have.
So I think maybe not so much for the guys, but I think for the ladies, it's trying to understand what motivates them. So if you try to get them at an early enough age and present them with all the different options, that's really the best way to do it. And it is about demystifying. And I think I look back now, and even now, when I see hacking or stuff, I kind of switch off a little bit. That's because I'm not particularly passionate about it, because the way I've grown up with it is it definitely was something that the boys did. But if I probably sat down and did it, right, and maybe had a bit more exposure to it, I might feel a little bit more interested. So it's a bit of hands-on. It's a bit of role model, I think, is quite important. So somebody like Ellie would be great to go into schools and say, hey, look, this is what I do. These are the different kind of, you know, the different options that you have. Because there's no motivation for them to do it otherwise.
Yeah. Well, then again, yesterday we had a couple of cryptographers, women too, very mathematical, very nerdy stuff. I didn't understand anything of it, so even there are a few women. But I think one way to make it more fun for you girls is to organize, right? You already mentioned the networks, you collaborate, you bring in the female factor, as we would say. So therefore, it was quite a surprise to see. This morning, there was Women in Cybersecurity Breakfast. Yes. Well, Women in Cybersecurity is also a network organization here in the Netherlands. Anouk Vos, Ioa Karels, and Mary Jo van der Velde, they organized this. There's already 300 women in high positions continuously organizing it. The only disadvantage was that it was female only. I wasn't invited to the breakfast. So that's
you tried.
Yeah, I tried to get in, but I couldn't. I'm a man. I'm sorry I'm a man, but you were hosting it. How was it this morning?
It was fantastic, and I'm always happy to host this, because I think it's a great initiative, and that women should really learn to network. That is something we hardly ever do in the right way. This morning was women only, but I have to set straight that this network is also available for men. So when they have certain events, men are more than welcome. Only this morning we thought it was good to have a meeting with women only. So we are fully aware that it's not about women and men apart. It is about doing things together, and it's about bringing in, as you beautifully mentioned, certain skills, and certain ways of thinking, that diversity makes it better. And we're not just talking about men and women, but also about people of different backgrounds and different religions. And And I think that's only a matter of time.
Yeah.
You were there too, right, this morning?
Yeah.
But I do believe it was the possibly worst moment to have an organization, because yesterday they had the social event on the beach, so it was probably late, and this was early, but was everybody just still
attending? I think so. Everyone was really happy to be there and was participating. We did some kind of workshopping, you know, writing on paper on the wall and stuff as well.
So
it wasn't just
really
ladies
and
lunch. It was quite interactive.
Okay, so what came out of the workshops? Can you give a couple
of
examples?
We were trying to kind of understand culturally what perhaps needs to change to make women more inclined to become part of the kind of cyber world. Educationally, is there something that we could be doing at kind of school level?
Okay.
And there was another, I didn't get that far along though on the board. I can't remember what it was. Mm. I think it was about traits or individual aspects that maybe contribute to a good cybersecurity professional.
Okay. What was your experience this morning?
Well, I shared my experience in my career, so I shared a bit of the lessons I've learned along the way, and that was highly appreciated. And I think that is one way to start networking, is to share your life lessons.
Mm.
And it was very well appreciated, and it was a real pleasure to do that.
Yeah. Okay. You're part of a similar network group in the UK. It's called Women's Security Society, so it's more the broader security issues, but probably also an ICT network in there.
Yeah.
How is it arranged in the UK?
So I co-founded the Women's Security Society with a colleague of mine who called up one day, and it just so happened that her name is also a guy's name, and she's often gone into a room and been given the minutes to photocopy, because there was an assumption that, of course, that person was not the male version.
Mm.
Why could she be doing this job? And when she sat down and actually led the meeting, they were surprised. So she called me and said, you know, we need to think about how we can do something about this. So we did a bit of market research and realized that there were individual groups out there. There's Women in Fraud Network in the United Kingdom. We have Women in Physical Security, and we have Women in Cyber. But I truly believe in convergent security, so I believe in bringing all aspects of security together in organizations.
Yes.
I believe in the Chief Security Officer, that individual that has somebody that is technical or has an information security leader next to him, but looks across all aspects of security, because it's not just about cyber.
Yeah.
Threat to organizations comes from all angles. So
that,
and that's how the Women's Security Society was set up.
So security is not only cyber, you agree?
I fully agree. Cyber is part. When we did the nuclear summit, it was about both worlds. And for the Netherlands, it was a great opportunity to bring them together and be fully aware of the fact that they do influence each other. So, you know, it's like paying attention to your front door while your window is open.
Okay.
I mean, we work closely. We have a criminologist who sits on our board as well. So you look from an academic perspective, the mind of the cyber criminal, and psychologists who support in doing that. So, and these guys aren't technical at all. Mm. They just understand crime, which effectively is predominantly what we're looking at here.
Okay, very good. Jane, here in the Tech Talk studio, we broadcast the opinions of many of the visitors, keynote speakers, to the broader audience. You're probably heading now to some of the sessions. Any last words for people now watching at home?
About what? About this?
About the conference.
Oh, right. Sorry, I thought you just meant about life.
You can share all your thoughts about life too, yes. How's your life at home?
Yeah, no, I know. Tiring.
No, about the conference. Any last words about cybersecurity or security in general?
So I think having a conference like this is invaluable, because it brings people from all different walks of life together, from government, from industry. And when we look at smart coalitions, just networking, having a coffee, I've already exchanged I don't know how many business cards, and people have discussed things, you know, that we're also experiencing in the United Kingdom. So I'd say let's do more of this type of stuff, whether it be formally like this or informally. If you're just meeting somebody from here in a coffee shop, it's to be encouraged all the way.
Networking is most important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not only for men, but for women too. Okay. So hope to see you back later. We'll see you back later.
Absolutely.
Hopefully at one of the other items, but you're very busy today. So Jane Wainwright, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jane.
Thanks, Eddie.